Abigail, but you can call me Abby. And this is the Stardew Story. One of the best known poets in the whole world, titled Mask of the Red Death. The Mask of the Red Death originally published The Mask of the Red Death, a fantasy, was been published in 1842, a short story fantasy made by Edgar Allan Poe. This story was been a fantasy, a horror, and a mysterious story. And this story is what I'm gonna tell you. The Red Death had long devastated the country. No pestilence had ever been so fatal or so hideous.
Blood was its avatar and its seal. The redness and horror of blood.
There were sharp pains and sudden dizziness, and then profuse bleeding at the pores with dissolution.
The scarlet stains upon the body, and especially upon the face of the victim, were the best bond which shut him out from the aid and from the sympathy of his fellow men.
And the whole seizure, progress and termination of the disease, were the incidents of half an hour.
But the Prince Prospero was happy and dauntless and sagacious. When his dominion were half depopulated, he summoned to his presence 1,000 hale and light-hearted friends from among the knights and dames of his court, and with these retired to the deep seclusion of one of his castellated abbeys.
It was toward the close of the 5th or 6th month of his seclusion, and while the pestilence raged most furiously abroad, that the Prince Prospero entertained his 1,000 friends at the mass ball of the most unusual magnificence.
It was a voluptuous scene, that masquerade. But first, let me tell of the rooms in which it was held. There were 7 an imperial suite in many palaces. However, such suites from a long and straight vista, where the folding doors lie back near walls on either hand, so that the view of whole extent is scarcely impeded. Here the case was very different, as might have been expected from the Duke's love of the bizarre. The apartments were so irregularly disposed that the visions embraced but little more than one at a time. There was a sharp turn at a very 20 or 30 yards. That at eastern extremity was hung, for example, in blue, and vividly blue were its window.
The second chamber was purple in its ornaments and tapestries, and here the panes were purple. The third was green throughout, and so were the casements. The fourth was furnished and lighted with orange, the fifth with white, the sixth with violet. The seventh apartment was closely shrouded in black velvet tapestries that hung all over the ceiling and down the walls, falling in heavy folds upon a carpet of the same material and hue. But in this chamber only, the color of the windows failed to correspond with the decorations. The panes here were scarlet, a deep blood color. Now in no one of the 7 apartments was there any lamp or candelarium. Amid the profusion of golden ornaments that lay scattered to and fro or depended from the roof, there was no light of any kind emanating from lamp or candle within the suite of chambers. But in the corridors that followed the suite, there stood Opposite to each window, a heavy tripod bearing a brazier of fire that protected its rays through the tinted glass and so glaringly illumined the room, and thus were produced a multitude of gaudy and fantastic appearances. But in the western or black chamber, the effect of the firelight that streamed upon the dark hangings through the blood-tinted panes was ghastly in the extreme, and produced so wild a look upon the countenances of those who entered, that there were few of the company bold enough to set foot within its precincts at all.
It was in this apartment, also, that there stood against the western wall a gigantic clock of ebony. Its pendulum swung to and fro with a dull, heavy, monotonous clang, and when the mute hand made the circuit of the face and the hour was to be stricken, there came from the brazen lungs of the clock a sound which was clear and loud and deep and exceedingly musical, but of so peculiar a note and emphasis that at each lapse of an hour, the musicians of the orchestra were constrained to pause momentarily in their performance, to hearken to the sound, and thus the waltzers perforce cease their evolutions, and there was a brief disconcert to the whole gay company. And while the chimes of the clock yet rang, it was observed that the giddiest grew pale, and the more aged and sedate passed their hands over their brows as if in confused reverie or meditation.
But when the echoes had fully ceased, a light laughter at once pervaded the assembly. The musicians looked at each other and smiled as if their own nervousness and folly, and made whispering vows, each to the other, that the next chiming of the clock should produce in them no similar emotion. And then, after the lapse of 60 minutes, which embraced 3,600 seconds of time that flies, there came yet another chiming of the clock, and then were the same disconcert and tremulousness and meditation as before.
But, in spite of this thing, it was a gay and magnificent revel. The tastes of Duke were peculiar. He had a fine eye for colors and effects. He disregarded the decora of mere fashion. His plans were bold and fiery, and his conception glowed with barbaric luster. There are some who would have thought him mad. His followers felt that he was not. It was necessary to hear and see and touch him to be sure that he was not.
He had directed in great part the movable embellishments of the seven chambers. Upon occasion of this great fete, and it was his own guiding taste which had given characters to the masqueraders, be sure they were rustique. There were much glare and glitter and piquancy and phantasm, much of what has been seen in Hernani. There were arabesque figures with unsuited limbs and appointments. There were delirious fancies such as madman fashions. There was much of the beautiful, much of the wanton, much of the bizarre, something of the terrible, and not a little of that which might have excited disgust. To and fro in the seven chambers there stalk, in fact, a multitude of dreams. And this, the dreams, writhed in and about, taking you from the rooms, and causing the wild music of the orchestra to seem as the echo of their steps. And anon, their strikers, the ebony clock which stands in the hall of the velvet, and then, for a moment, all is still, and all is silent, save the voice of the clock.
The dreams are stiff, frozen as they stand, but the echoes of the chime die away. They have endured but an instant, and the light half subdued laughter floats after them as they depart. And now again the music swell, and the dreams live, and the writ to and from more merely than ever, taking you from many tinted windows through which stream the rays from the tripods. But to the chamber which lies most westwardly of the seven, there are now none of markers whose venture, for the night is waning away, and there flows a ruder light through the blood-colored panes, and the blackness of the sable draper appals, and to him whose foot falls upon the sable carpet. There comes from the near clock of ebony a muffled peal, more solemnly epic than any which reaches their ears, whose include in
the more remote glitches of the other apartments.
But these other apartments were densely crowded, and in the beat feverishly the heart of life. And the revent went wearingly on, until a length commenced the sound of midnight upon the clock. And then the music ceased, as I have told. And the evolution of Waltzer were quieted, and there was an easy sensation of things as before. But now there were 12 strokes to be sounded by the bell of the clock. And thus it happened. Perhaps the more of thought crept with more of time into the meditation of thought pool among those who rebuilt. And thus, too, it happened, perhaps, that the crowd who have found leisure to become aware of the presence of mass figure, which had arrested the attention of no single individual before, and the rumor of this new presence having spread itself whisperingly around, then arose at length from the whole company a buzz or a murmur expressive of disapprobation and surprise. Then, finally, of terror, of horror, and of disgust.
In an assembly of phantasms, such as I have painted, it may well be supposed that no ordinary appearance could have excited such sensation. In truth, the masquerade license of the night was nearly unlimited, but the figure in question had out eroded Herod and gone beyond the bounds of even the prince's indefinite decorum. There are chords in the hearts of the most reckless which cannot be touched without emotion. Even with utterly lost, to whom life and death are equally jests, there are matters of which no jest can be made. The whole company, indeed, seem now deeply to feel in the costume and bearing of the stranger, neither wit nor propriety existed. The figure was tall and gaunt, and shrouded from head to foot in the habiliments of the grave. The mask which concealed the visage was made so nearly to resemble the countenance of a stiffened corpse that the closest scrutiny must have had difficulty in detecting the cheat, and yet all this might have been injured if not approved by the mad revelers around. But the mummer had gone so far. His vesture was doubled in blood, and his broad brow, with all the features of the face, was besprinkled with the scarlet horror.
When the eyes of Prince Prospero fell upon this spectral image, which with slow and solemn movement, as if more fully sustained its role, struck to and fro among the waltzers, he was seen to be convulsed. In the first moment with strong shudder, either of terror or distaste. But in the next, his brow reddened with rage. "Who dares insult us with this blasphemous mockery? Seize him and unmask him, that we may know whom we have to hang at sunrise from the battlements." It was in the eastern or blue chamber in which stood the Prince Prospero as he uttered these words. They rang throughout the seven rooms loudly and clearly, for the prince was bold and robust man, and the music had become hushed and at the waving of his hand.
It was in the blue room where stood the prince, with a group of pale courtiers by his side. At first, as he spoke, there was a slight rushing movement of this group in the direction of the intruder, who at the moment was also near at the hand, and now, with deliberate and stately step, made closer approach to the speaker. But from a certain nameless awe with which the mad assumption of the mummer had inspired the whole party, there were found none to who put forth hand to seize him, so that unimpeded, he passed within a yard of the prince's person.
And while the vast assembly, as if with one impulse, shrunk from the centers of the rooms to the walls, he made his way uninterruptedly, but with the same solemn and measured step which had distinguished him from the first, through the blue chamber to the purple, through the purple to the green, through the green to the orange, through this again to the white, and even thence to the violet. Ere our decided movement had been made to arrest him. It was then, however, that the Prince Prospero, maddening with the rage and the shame of his own momentary cowardice, rushed hurriedly through the six chambers, while none followed him on account of a deadly terror that had seized upon all. He bore aloft a drowned dagger, and had approached, in rapid impetuosity, to within 3 or 4 feet of the retreating figure, when the latter, having attained the extremity of the velvet apartment, turned suddenly and confronted his pursuer.
There was a sharp cry, and the dagger dropped gleaming upon the sable carpet, which instantly afterwards fell prostrate in death the Prince Prospero. Then summoning the wild courage of despair, a throng of the revelers at once threw themselves into the black apartment and seizing the mummer, whose tall figure stood erect and motionless within the shadow of the ebony clock, gasped in unutterable horror at finding the grave cerements and corpse-like mass which they handled with so violent a rudeness, untenanted by any tangible form.
Now was acknowledged the presence of the Red Death. He had come like a thief in the night, and one by one dropped the revelers in the blood-bedewed halls of their revel, and died each in the despairing posture of his fall. And the life of the ebony clock went out with that of the last of the gay, and the flames of the tripods expired, and the darkness and decayed, and the Red Death held eliminated dominion over all. The end. The end. And again, this is Stardew Stories. And again, I'm Abby. And I'm with my...
With Arthur!
Go, guys!
With my...